With phase 4 that has been up and running and the products coming out of Marvel and DC being key motivating factors to influence audiences to step into theaters globally, it's safe to say that the movie experiences have been nothing short of unpredictable. Inventive attempts like Shang-Chi and Perfect Fan Service with No Way Home would be followed by extremely messy products like Multiverse of Madness and the colossal hot garbage that was Thor: Love and Thunder. Irrespective, there's always the attempt to look at the glass half full and expect to be surprised with the next venture coming out of the Marvel Cinematic Universe, and in comes Ant-Man and the Wasp: Quantumania. It's the third Ant-Man film and focuses on Scott Lang living successfully as an author with his girlfriend Hope and daughter Cassie. Regretting the time that has passed away from his daughter, especially Cassie's formative years, Scott is loving life as a devoted boyfriend and loving father, only for the gears to shift as Cassie reveals to the Lang family that she has developed a device that can contact the quantum realm. The signal gets transmitted and all of them get sucked into the quantum realm, a world Janet, the original Wasp, is of course privy to. How their journey makes them accustomed to the dynamics of the quantum realm and looming threat of one of the key motivating factors, by the way, that have people excited for this film, Kang, coming into the picture, played by Jonathan Majors. How he poses a threat to the Lang family and the world beyond the realms in general forms the basic storyline of this movie. Here's me telling you the good and bad aspects of the film so that you guys can ultimately decide whether to watch it in theaters or not. The good: influence and creative set pieces. The moment you start this film, you quickly realize it's a different template to most of the Marvel movies, at least the way it starts. Rather than being knowledgeable about the world of your favorite heroes and an impending threat that comes their way, in the case of this movie, we get transported to a new world within the first few minutes. The movie taking the shape of an adventure film to the likes of Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy or The Journey to the Center of the Earth. New developments, characters, and species are introduced and one gets accustomed to the quantum realm. This is interesting from a visual standpoint but lethargic from a storytelling point of view as the movie barely moves forward in its first half. Some of the creative set pieces, which include the drop into the quantum realm and the probability realm, need to be lauded, however, because they account for some wacky ideas that are technically to marvel at. Janet as the original Wasp and Jonathan Majors as Kang. I know everyone is only singing praises of Jonathan Majors in the film, but I right off the bat wanted to say that Michelle Pfeiffer as Janet really does put forth a very strong performance. Her relationship with the quantum realm and the burden she holds is prevalent in every frame. Her want to rectify her mistake becomes abundantly clear, and even though this film is titled Ant-Man and the Wasp, you quickly realize that Janet and Kang are running most of the show. The movie could have easily been titled Janet or Kang Ka Kadwa Sach. If there is an antagonist, however, that Marvel fans have been rooting for to meet the alarming threat that Thanos once had in this universe, they know they can have their eyes on Kang as the source for endless destruction. Jonathan Majors brings life into this film. So much life where I actually wondered how this film would have fared without him. We got introduced to Jonathan Majors in Loki, a calmer version of Kang, where he communicated how there may be several versions of him, having the clear possibility of being batshit crazy. Jonathan Majors has such a commanding presence as Kang, a confidence with his pitch, a clarity with his vision, that you can clearly understand why Scott and the Quantum as a whole gets intimidated on just the sheer capability he has as a character. It's absolutely true that the movie becomes extremely engaging whenever he appears on the screen, and my god, was absolutely relieved that they did not infuse unnecessary Marvel witty zingers and forced humor to the sequences he featured in. It would have absolutely butchered his impact, and if there is a key motivating factor for going for this film, it surely is Kang and, more importantly, his potential threat to the universe. The underwhelming aspects: lackluster CGI and routine third act. When you hear back-end stories of the pressure that is put on the special effects and VFX department to extract results in such a time crunch for Marvel movies, you understand why the movies presented on such a scale, even with their humongous budgets, miss the mark in terms of CGI. As the movie deals with the quantum realm, it of course results in the fact that every single aspect of the background at one point of time other than the actors has to be digitally created. While these portions still work well, as I previously said, of the journey and world building they do when the characters are in an explorative mode in the initial portions of the film, it really does take a dip into the uncomfortable and absurd, where it is a double whammy. Characters are CGI in a CGI world, making for the battle sequence, especially in the penultimate act, absolutely a sore to the eye. Such a heavy dependence in special effects in every feature is bound to lead to such results. But I wonder whether the problem is handling so many elements that need to be refined, or just the sheer regularity with which these movies get churned out, resulting in an absolute lack of time for the technical team. Too many characters and Marvel humor is getting stale. The more jokes I heard in this film that barely generated a laugh from the theater, the more I missed Michael Peña, who was such an essential and hilarious part of the Ant-Man films. A lot of the gags in the film are delivered with Cassie, Scott and MODOK, which I'm sure a lot of you look forward to, but barely do any of the jokes land. MODOK in his portrayal, I understand, is self-aware that it's kind of stupid and funny intentionally, but what made the compact villain so exciting in the cartoons, or even in the previous ventures, was that it was equally as hilarious as it was intimidating. And in the case of this film, I found him to be neither, as his face gets stretched out on an IMAX screen like a meme template gone wrong. A gag on the number of holes that one carries on their body goes on for far too long. Species who look like broccoli and MODOK not being a dick is just the same kind of stale integration of humor that we have become accustomed to and honestly tired of with Marvel movies. I heard Jeremy Jahn say this and I want to hear from you as well. Do I sound like an old hag when I say that the chirpy humor of most Marvel films just are getting tiring? Let me know in the comments below. I feel like Catherine Newton really missed the mark as Cassie when instructed to give a rousing speech, also barely packing the punch to influence an entire mob. Paul Rudd is almost in an autopilot mode and doesn't miss a beat, but I quickly realized that the crew of heroes are far too many to justifiably give them enough screen time, eventually leading to the core focus of the film being scattered through most of its running time. Duping loyal fans and how? I think one of the weakest arguments for a movie and something that really has duped loyal fans with this universe is to constantly tell them that a movie acts as a gateway to the other installments. So keep your expectations low, just have fun, watch it for entertainment are all statements mostly gatekeeping a movie that didn't hit the mark from a narrative point of view, especially a movie that is designed as the third installment of the Ant-Man saga. One bypasses the problems of a movie individually from a screenplay perspective if you just protect it under the guise of it will get better in the future installments because this was all world building. What essentially made us fall in love with Phase 3 was not only the way the world seamlessly connected to each other, but how the individual films also worked from a storytelling point of view. And I have to say that Ant-Man and the Wasp Quantumania, barring Jonathan Majors as Kang and the potential threat that he poses in the future, is mediocre at best. Fans of the universe understand the potential of superhero movies to be more than just entertainment. To be compelling, thought-provoking, sometimes even philosophical, as the source material of some of the most hard-hitting storylines with our favorite characters are readily available. The saturation of these films is not the reason why people are getting tired, but the exhaustion has set in because the films are not providing engaging narratives, just building blocks for an ultimate battle in so many cases. When you acknowledge this, then you know that Ant-Man and the Wasp Quantumania taps into way less than its real potential. And that was the video, guys. Write down in the comments below what you thought about the movie. Please don't forget to follow me on Instagram. The handle's right in front of you. Follow me at JammyPants4. Also, please support us by smashing the like button and subscribing to our channel for weekly content ahead. Thank you for watching.